Catherine the Great of Russia was not born in Russia. She was German, born Sophie Friederike Augusta Prinzessin of Anhalt-Zerbst in Prussia. And yet, Sophie would become Russia's monarch and go on to obtain the moniker the Great. Though faced with many uprisings in her time, she expanded Russia's territory. She led to wars against the Ottomans, annexed Crimea in 1783, setting the historical precedent, or excuse if you prefer, for another Russian leader centuries later. Another precedent, darker, she navigated the diplomatic waters and helped complete the partition of Poland in 1795. Catherine witnessed the French Revolution from afar, felt its tremblings all the way in Russia. She used her power in some traditional ways and some new ways, and unlike many who wield it, considered its limits. She exchanged letters with over 400 people through her reign, some of whom, Enlightenment figures like Diderot and Voltaire, would help her gain an additional label on top of great, enlightened. Enlightened autocrat is a tough sell, but there's no doubt that she engaged with Enlightenment thought, wanting to be seen as different from other rulers. And of that specific detail, there is no doubt. And with that, welcome, explorers. I'm William C. Fox. I'm currently writing these history videos in my free time, evenings, and weekends, so if you'd like to pitch in for my elaborate coffee fund and join a growing community of history lovers, head on over to patreon.com/William C. Fox. Catherine, as we said, was born Sophie, born to one of the many so-called princely families in Germany, basically this sprawling tree of people jockeying to go up or down a step in a crowded nobility. Sophie was born in Stettin, which is northeast of Berlin in modern-day northwest Poland. Sophie was German, but what is Germany in this period, you may ask? That's a great question. Germany was not unified, loaded term alert, until the 19th century efforts of Prussian Chancellor Otto von Bismarck to unify it with other German-speaking territories. At the time of Sophie's birth, Germany, as we know it today, was a scattering of around 300 sovereign principalities that spoke the German language, or dialects thereof. There were intermarriages, common cultural links, consolidations, and disassemblies. Sophie grew up in this scattered ecosystem. Despite her family's relative modesty, Sophie was still a pupil to private instructors who oversaw her education. And from younger than 10 years old, Sophie's mother took her on journeys through the German principalities, visiting and intriguing with other nobles and shopping the young Sophie around to potential families for her to marry into. In 1739, her mother took Sophie to meet someone who would become significant in her journey out of obscurity. Her uncle had recently become guardian to the young Duke of Holstein, Charles Peter Ulrich von Schleswig-Holstein-Gottorp. Let's just call him Peter, shall we? And immediately Sophie's mom and all these ladies start matchmaking these two young people. I mean, look at this kid. How couldn't they? Okay, but seriously, Peter's dad had married the daughter of Peter the Great, the late Emperor of Russia. That makes the young Peter that Sophie was meeting the grandson of Peter the Great. If Sophie's mom could arrange a marriage between Sophie and this Peter, well, Sophie would be moving up in the world. And she wrote about meeting Peter for the first time. Let's hang on her description of him as it will be relevant later. Here she is writing about that first encounter. She's 10, he's 11. In truth, his face was pale in color, and he seemed to be thin and of a delicate constitution. His attendees wanted to give this child the appearance of a mature man, and to this end they hampered and restrained him, which could only inoculate falseness in his conduct as well as his character. Well, not exactly a glowing endorsement. Now, Catherine the Great was writing retrospectively about this encounter with the benefit, or perhaps curse, of experience coloring her memories. Now, this isn't an episode of History Mystery, but here's a mystery. Both these kids are German-ish, both Sophie and Peter. Peter's grandfather was Peter the Great, but Peter was very German, didn't speak Russian, wasn't in the line of the Russian succession. Based on the matchmaking I just described, we can see how he and Sophie ended up together, but how did they end up together in Russia? Let's talk about Elizabeth, the Russian Empress. Elizabeth came to Russia's throne by military coup. Ivan VI was an infant emperor from 1740 to 41. His mother, Anna, assumed the role of regency for the baby. On December 5th, 1741, Ivan, this infant, and his mother were arrested and exiled in a coup. halt right there, baby. You're under arrest. And thus, Elizabeth became the Empress of Russia. Empress Elizabeth, however, did not have an heir. And so one of the first things she did was import her nephew, Peter, who we met earlier, from Prussia. He would be her chosen heir to the throne. But while Empress Elizabeth brought her Prussian nephew to Russia, she simultaneously appointed Alexei Petrovich Bestuzhev-Ryumin, let's just call him Bestuzhev, as vice chancellor in 1741. He exerted significant influences on matters of foreign policy, the cornerstone of which was that he wanted to pivot Russia away from alliance with Prussia and towards England and Austria. And this preference in foreign policy, which came to the fore at the start of Elizabeth's reign, actually helps us solve this little history mystery. Bestuzhev wanted to pivot away from Prussia. Well, recently ascended to the throne of Prussia was none other than Frederick II, who would come to be known as Frederick the Great. Frederick knew about Bestuzhev in the Russian court, and he wanted to stop, or at least slow, Russia's diplomatic pivot away from Prussia. Frederick looked at the situation and saw that Elizabeth had brought her Prussian nephew, Peter, to be her heir. So Frederick came up with a plan. He decided to help send Elizabeth a Prussian wife for her Prussian heir. That wife would be Sophie. If Elizabeth had two Prussians so prominent in her family, she wouldn't turn her back on their home so easily. Frederick went on the offensive for Sophie's family, of whom the Empress Elizabeth was already aware. To increase the family's profile, Frederick advanced Sophie's father to field marshal, encouraged Sophie's mom to send portraits of the young Sophie to St. Petersburg, and finally facilitated travel expenses for Sophie and her mother to travel to Russia and make it all official, as in get Sophie married to Peter so they could start producing male children, heirs for Elizabeth. For Sophie's low, noble house, receipt of a letter instructing them to head to Russia so their daughter could marry the heir to the throne was a great usurpation. No foreshadowing intended. Sophie was on track to be on the Russian throne by Peter's side. Granted, it would be a position with relatively little real power, but hey, she was on her way. When Sophie arrived in Moscow, she immediately began to observe the politics of the court. She noticed, for example, how the power flowed. There were two groups Sophie wrote about in the court of Elizabeth, both of whom we already met briefly. One group that was excited about the arrival of this German girl because they had helped arrange it, the pro-Frederick, pro-Prussia group. The other was led by Vice Chancellor Bestuzhev, who we met earlier as well. Remember, he was leading Elizabeth in her foreign policy, and he was anti-Prussia, wanting to pivot to England and Austria. Beyond court politics, Sophie also spent some time getting to know her fiancé, Peter. But the more they got to know each other, the clearer it became they just weren't compatible. Peter was strange, and more importantly, he was Russophobic, as in the man didn't like Russia, the very country he was supposed to rule over. Okay, now we're gonna do a new segment. That's right, a new segment, because we're TV now. We're calling it In Defense Of. For the premiere edition, In Defense Of the Grand Duke, later known as Emperor Peter III. Granted, as we've hinted at, Peter was a weirdo. He read smut, played with soldiers into adulthood, hosted puppet theater on the regular, fetishized Frederick II and Prussia, put a mouse on trial in Sophie's bedroom, found it guilty, and decapitated it. But more fundamentally, he was threatening to her. In one case, he threatened her physically during childbirth, was emotionally abusive, cruel to people around him, servants, joked around at funerals. The list goes on. But not excusing any of that, in defense of Peter, he was orphaned, then emotionally and physically abused as a child, including public floggings, 40 lashes. He was exposed early to alcohol and alcoholism, forced to leave a home he apparently really missed, and to top it off, he had multiple episodes of pox, which left his skin, his face, scarred. After a particularly rough bout, Sophie, quote, found it difficult to recognize him. In truth, he had become hideous. In short, Peter was a victim that would go on to victimize others. Unlike her fiancé, Peter, Sophie took great pains to learn Russian, dedicating herself to the language as a means of ingratiating herself with the people of her adopted home. She wrote in her memoir that she would stay up late at night, dwelling on her Russian lessons. I rose from my bed at night, and while everyone slept, memorized the lessons. Sophie was learning to be a smooth political actor, to exploit situations even when she was sick. Once, ill in bed, she asked for an Orthodox priest in front of Empress Elizabeth. Sophie's family was Lutheran, and to join the Russian court, she was expected to convert to Orthodox Christianity. It's not clear the details of the faith were important to her, but it was an important gesture to the Empress, who herself was quite devoted to religion. Sophie wrote in her memoir that, quote, "This act gained me great favor in the opinion of the Empress Elizabeth and of the entire court." Before her wedding day, Sophie was officially converted into the Orthodox Church and thus took on a new Russian name, the name she would carry into power, Ekaterina, Catherine. Peter and Catherine were married in 1745, the start of years of misery. Catherine and Peter didn't like each other and weren't in a rush to consummate their marriage to produce an heir. For this, Empress Elizabeth would make their life hell for the next decade. Miserable in her marriage, Catherine began reading. A French spy would later comment that, quote, "Her hermit-like mode of life has forced her to occupy herself with reading." Many of the books were philosophy and substantive fiction, Plato, Montesquieu's Spirit of Laws, Diderot, even Voltaire. She spent considerable time with skeptical Enlightenment products like Diderot's Encyclopedia and Pierre Bayle's Historical and Critical Dictionary. She was advised to get copies of works of Plutarch and read the Roman historian Tacitus. And Catherine started to base her identity in these readings, scribbling in the margins in her memoirs. She wrote, "I actually did put in writing my portrait, which I entitled Portrait of the Philosopher at age 15. Many years later, namely in the year 1758, I found this work and was astonished by the depth of self-knowledge that it contained." Okay, bit of an ego there, but all right. While Catherine was reading and writing her days away, Empress Elizabeth pressed the young royal couple to produce an heir. With things ice cold between her and Peter for over 5 years of marriage, no consummation, Catherine took up an affair with Sergei Saltykov to meet her emotional and physical needs. The affair between Saltykov and Catherine did in fact produce an heir for Elizabeth. After two miscarriages, Catherine gave birth to a son, Paul, in 1754. The real identity of the boy's father was either not known or actively ignored. The timing must have seemed perfect to Empress Elizabeth, whose health was in noticeable decline. With the newborn, her succession was secured. Peter would follow her, then Paul. Done. But there's something Elizabeth didn't plan for: the growing ambitions of Catherine. In this period, the late 1750s, Catherine had time to think about what she would do once Elizabeth was gone. Her husband, Peter, would become the Emperor of Russia, but given their estranged and hostile relations, her role was likely to be minor, if he kept her around at all. Catherine did more than simply envision how she would survive. She started scheming, becoming desirous to be obeyed. In the summer of 1756, she wrote to the British ambassador, Sir Charles, a letter in which she conjured a plan to find allies and, quote, "make herself obeyed" in the minutes and hours following the death of the Empress. She had insiders feeding her information on the Empress's health, furthering her apprenticeship in court intelligence gathering, building basic alliances. She was determined to, as she put it, perish or reign. It's hard to imagine a time when Empress Elizabeth's death would be timely, but this was a particularly poor moment for her health to decline. Russia was at war, and not just at war with anyone, Russia was at war with Frederick's Prussia. In 1756, the Seven Years' War inflamed pre-existing tension in the Russian court. In this war, Great Britain supported Prussia, which stood against Russia, Austria, and France. The fact that Russia stood in opposition to Frederick II and Prussia was a logical conclusion of Elizabeth's rise to power and early foreign policy, but foretold trouble. Her heir, Peter's Germanness and his fetishization of Frederick would lead to his open partisanship against Elizabeth's participation in the war against Prussia. If Elizabeth were to die, Peter would ascend the throne and surely end Russia's involvement. The stakes were high. Sure enough, Elizabeth died in early 1762, and Peter became Emperor Peter III, 34 years old. There were already rumblings that Catherine might take power instead of her husband, but it simply wasn't the right time to take action. When an ally wrote to her that she could simply give the order, quote, "and we will enthrone you," Catherine quickly rejected the offer. First, she was very pregnant with the child of a man named Grigory Orlov, more on him soon. Second, she may have still believed at this time she could influence Peter, wield power by neutralizing him, being competent for him in places he was incompetent. She was wrong. As emperor, Peter's relationship with Catherine carried on just as before, incredibly distant, separate, coming together only for official functions and keeping up appearances. Peter was maintaining the status quo in his private affairs, enjoying life with his mistress and ignoring Catherine's enjoyment of her lover, Grigori Orlov, and their new child. In public life, however, Peter was upending the political status quo of Russia in the middle of a war. First things first, Peter made a spectacle of Elizabeth's funeral, running around childishly during the funeral procession, cracking loud jokes, standing when he should sit, sitting when he should stand, and canceling the period of mourning quite early. Second, Peter immediately pulled out of the war against Prussia, halted all hostilities, and signed a peace treaty which gave back all territory obtained through the conflict. Peter wasn't making any friends. He was changing all sorts of policies quickly, upsetting this group and that. Peter also openly discussed making his mistress empress and ditching Catherine and Paul. There were rumors he was going to have Catherine arrested and sent to a covenant to pave the way for his mistress, or maybe even have Catherine poisoned. Catherine wrote in this period about her sacrificial, altruistic nature. She was shouldering a burden that was, quote, just about at the limit. She described her situation as akin to the plight of Prometheus, suffering for others. So while Peter was mucking things up, his wife was building a personal narrative and, as we'll see in a bit, a patriotic narrative to justify the actions she would take to usurp him. An open discussion began of Peter's removal. Conspirators wondered whether to make Catherine's son, Paul, then 7 years old, the emperor, or whether Catherine might ascend to the throne bypassing her son. It's unclear when exactly Catherine became involved in planning her husband's overthrow, though she claimed it had been 6 months in the making. What we know for sure is that in June 1762, while Peter was away, Catherine spent some time with some of those who would be linchpins in her rise. One person she spent time with was a soldier who knew other soldiers. As we learned, Catherine had begun an affair with a Russian officer, Grigori Orlov. She even bore him a son. That's important because Orlov's brothers were also in the military. Therefore, when the time was right, the Orlov cohort could be instrumental in bringing her to power. By forming a bond with Orlov, Catherine opened the doors of the military establishment for her personal use. She would need the help sooner rather than later. After what Catherine claimed were 3 weeks of coup planning, one member of the conspiracy was unexpectedly arrested in St. Petersburg in July 1762. It seemed as though the conspiracy was exposed. They would need to act fast to rescue the operation. So the plan to take power was moved up. Learning of the arrest of the fellow conspirator, Catherine hopped in a carriage and headed straight for St. Petersburg. She was proclaimed empress twice that day at two stops along the way, once with some of the military where early morning cheers of celebration were orchestrated by the Orlovs. Her second proclamation was staged with clergy of the Russian Orthodox Church. She was waving from the balcony of the Winter Palace by 10 a.m. While all this was going on, her first manifesto was published. It gave three main reasons to justify her accession to the throne. First, Russia's sacred Orthodox Church had been endangered by Peter's Lutheranism. Second, Peter's withdrawal from the war with Prussia was bad. And third, government institutions were in trouble, presumably a reference to debt. More was published in the following days explaining that she was forced to take power in reaction to the death threats against her by Peter. The madman had to be stopped. She pushed all the buttons. How did Catherine consolidate power in St. Petersburg that day? Well, first and foremost, bars and taverns were pressured to hand out free booze. No, really, it created a party atmosphere. Second, a few key people were arrested. Imported German lieutenants from regiments, a Holstein prince and advisor to Peter, the police master. Other key people who weren't arrested, government officials and the like, were pressured to swear allegiance to Catherine. On the outskirts of town, approaching people were stopped and given a sniff test, so to speak. Were they friend, or were they sent by that pesky Peter? Speaking of Peter, what was Peter doing during his ejection from the throne? Well, he was chilling, unaware. Once made aware of the coup a full day later, he opted against marching on St. Petersburg to assert himself by force, and instead decided to get drunk and then leisurely sailed towards a fortified island near St. Petersburg. He was forced to turn around by forces loyal to Catherine. It was all a bit pathetic. Had he taken the advice given him, taken a select group, stormed into St. Petersburg, and confronted Catherine, he might have remained emperor. But without this counteraction, Catherine's confidence grew. Having heard through the grapevine of her husband's hesitation and hiccup at sea, she decided to make a risky move, leave the seat of government, track Peter down, and have him arrested. But she didn't do it alone. She dressed in a military outfit, that's the moment this painting shows, and rode in front of an overwhelming force of thousands against her husband. But before they could even get to him, news arrived that Peter had been taken into custody by their allies. Arrested and forced to sign an abdication of the throne, Peter was humiliated. His idol, Frederick II, described his dethroning like a child being sent to bed. Ouch. Peter was held prisoner in a fortress, personally guarded by one of the Orloff brothers, Alexei. The story gets a bit murky here, but in mid-July 1762, Alexei wrote a letter to Catherine explaining that Peter had been killed during a drunken brawl. Specifically, Peter had been strangled. A murdered Peter was not a good look, so the official cause of death of Emperor Peter III was claimed to be an acute attack of hemorrhoids. One Frenchman would later jokingly comment that he wouldn't visit Russia because in Russia, hemorrhoids were life-threatening. If Peter's murder was prearranged, if Catherine knew explicitly of the plan, we don't have evidence of it. Most likely the topic went unspoken. The Orloffs killed Peter to secure their own positions in Catherine's new regime, knowing his continued existence would pose a threat to her, and therefore, to them. To me, how Catherine took the Russian throne goes further than just staging the coup and the murder of Peter. To stay on that throne, to have it be seen as legitimate, those roots go much deeper. While her husband spoke with a heavy accent, disdained Russia and its institutions, its religion, etc., Catherine had, despite her similar German origins, by this time in her life, completely embraced her Russianness. Its language, its customs, its religion. Undoubtedly, this image she had been cultivating since her arrival in Moscow as a teenager, this personal brand, I dare say, benefited her greatly. A German hadn't usurped a German, a Russian had usurped a German. In Catherine's own words, "I wanted to be Russian in order that the Russians should love me." Catherine's coronation was on the 22nd of September, 1762, a veritable Russian spectacle in its old capital and beating heart, Moscow. The ceremonial canons started early that morning. The disordered party atmosphere lasted far longer. And that, my friends, is how Catherine the Great, the most powerful woman in the history of Russia, came to power. Click this video to see how Abraham Lincoln came to power. Follow me at William C. Fox and tell me which historical figures rise to power I should cover next. Later, y'all.